Ja.
Så sidder jeg lidt om på kaffe og går på en lille mand i sofaen.
Går nok. Vi kan redigere.
lovely building. I don't need a microphone, do I, really? It's a great building, this. They tell me they used to play squash downstairs. Is that right? Badminton or something? I'm a former badminton champion. And then I woke up. That's nice to be here. Okay. I'm going to need that. I'm going to be playing along with some tracks from an album I did a few years back called Stacks. And these are the backing tracks that I mixed down from the original tracks. And this one here, advertising first. But it's the backing tracks you'll hear from the Stax album. And I've got a few of those with me. There's not many these days, but this is the first one. Track one, please. Thank you. okay for you?
Yeah.
Can you hear this?
Yes.
Sorry about that. Good. This is my signature guitar. This is a PRS guitar, which is about 2 years old now, a little bit more. And they just have increased the production of them. They're doing some custom colors, and they're doing a spalted maple one, which is lovely. And it's one of the top selling guitars in the world, ladies and gentlemen, at the moment. So, main reason being, because it's me. Main reason being, it's very, very affordable. That's what it is. Pori Smith is a very good friend of mine, apart from working together. He's, Paul is a, I don't know if you've ever seen him play, he's a really good guitar player, but he's a guitar nut, he's crazy. And when he first asked me to join the company as an artist, we had a long discussion because it was going to be an American guitar made in the States. And I just said, well, that's lovely, thank you very much, I'm very honored. And I said, how much is that guitar going to cost? And he said, well, I guess it'll be within the same range as most of the American guitars we have. So I went, And he looked at me and he went, well, what's wrong with that? And I said, well, the thing I do a lot is this kind of thing. And when I do shows, I always like to meet people and say hello because I don't have many friends. And as my daughter always points out, well, you don't have any friends, do you, Dad? So you have to meet the people who come to see your concert. Anyway, apart from that. And I wanted a guitar that was affordable because if you start a conversation with a guy that says, I would love to have one of your guitars, but it's way beyond my capability, the price range, it's not the greatest way to start a conversation. So we agreed almost immediately, really, to go for these Korean guitars, and I have to tell you, they are absolutely amazing. The quality control is fantastic, and I get an email every day from somebody who bothers to say that they've... I've had an email this morning from Australia saying that the guy just bought one of these in Australia. He bought it on Thursday. So it goes on every day. So somebody is, you know, they're the ones who bother to email me. So I'm very pleased with this, and I'm very pleased to be associated with the Paul Reed Smith Company. And if it sounds okay, there's one in the hall downstairs, if you like it. They usually get me to play it, and then they can sell it after the show. That's what they do. But I brought this one with me. This is going, I like this. This is one of my favorite ones.
How much is it?
I think about £600 UK, maybe a bit more, maybe a bit less if you find a discount shop. So, you know, it's... A lot of people are saying to me they go in to buy a... They buy it as a second guitar. And then I get emails and people contact me and they say, it's become my first guitar and I've sold my other guitar and stuff like that. So, it does what it does. There's been some changes on some of them. They upgraded some pickups. They did use some American pickups and stuff like that. And... But it's basically, I mean, this is a guitar that is straight out of the box. There's nothing added or taken away for this one for me, so that's what it does. Well, I was going to say, anybody got any questions? But we've started, so anybody else have any questions? You can ask about anything at all, I don't mind. I might not answer everything, but... yes, ma'am?
What pickup do you use?
This one or this one? You're going to ask me technical questions now, aren't you? Six strings. I'm not very technical. This makes it go loud. That's when I turn that. These are standard Korean pickups. They're humbucking pickups. And the strings are, I think they come with 10 to 46, which I've gone up a gauge since then. The older I get, the strings seem to get as old as me, I'm not sure. But it's a... Oh, thank you. Accompaniment. Two volumes and just one tone, because every guitar has two tones, but oh no, anybody ever uses two tones. Anyway, somebody's going to go, yeah, me, I do. So this is just one tone. So I'm very happy with this guitar, and it sounds pretty good. So I'm going to play some more on it. Shall I do that? You're looking at me now saying which track, I have no idea.
Check it on this.
Strangely
enough, number two.
That's how rehearsed I am, kind of. It's great.
you to BB King. Siden og helt over ved siden af scenen her. Så prøv at trække lidt længere ind, så der er nogle flere, der kan se Bernie. Tak. Over to you. Whatever he said. He was going to pull me off.
Nope.
I should rephrase that. I said that. So B.B. King was a great influence on me, and that's my kind of homage to him. I was very lucky. He inspired me to pick up a guitar. I guess the Beatles. Maybe a little bit before. Maybe the Shadows and people like that. But the Beatles were, when I was a kid, when I was probably your age. That was the main reason. I was lucky when I was probably about 18 months into it. A guy, family personal, who played the guitar. And he came down to me, and I had all these Jerry and the Pacemakers records, Freddie and the Dreamers, The Searchers, and all this kind of thing. And I said, look, I can do this, you know, sweet for my sweet. Do the format. And he said, he looked at me like that. So you can play that thing then? I said, yeah. He was a bit older than me. And he threw all these records in a bin, and he gave me a Muddy Waters and a Howlin' Wolf album. He said, if you're going to play the guitar, he said, don't play that shit, play this. So I have a lot to thank him for, really. So that was the kind of guy. So I got into blues, and then by then I discovered people like B.B. King and Eric Clapton. And here I am. So that's a do a harmony, it's a any more questions? Yes, sir.
What happened to you and Wax Lake? You co-wrote the novel Singles and you were on the tour. I saw Wax Lake go
in the sense of Jimmy's and you were there. Yeah, it wasn't me.
No?
Did you notice? The whole thing, I'm just a, I keep saying that, get embarrassed because of the internet these days. I'm almost ready to finish a book, and there's quite a lot about the whole Saints and Sinners thing because of the way the album was released. It was kind of inferred that none of the original band were on the album when everybody was, and there was a little song on there called Here I Go Again, which did quite well. I think I was on that album because that song definitely is on it. So. No, I mean, it's one of those things. At the time, there was just just had a picture of David on the back, and you know, it was a funny period because the band was kind of disintegrating within, not in a nasty way. It was just getting to that point where we were five or six albums in, and you know, there was some of the spark had gone, and so that was what happened. And then they came back after we would all kind of gone away, and a couple of the other guys had gone away, and then the album came out. With all of us on it, so and it did pretty well. Funny enough, I listened to Saints and Sinners. I had to for a project to a guy in Canada, and I hadn't listened to it in quite a long time. And I was amazed how good it is because I know what was going on at the time. But it shows what a good sort of setup we were because there's no real obvious sign that there was problems. I don't think there are anyway, but there were problems. Yeah, but that's kind of the story. There'll be a lot more about it in the book. Sold one copy of the book. I'll sign it for you, I promise. Anybody else? Yes, mate.
Now, in advice for
upcoming
guitarists,
yeah.
What advice would you give to them?
Yeah, get a good lawyer. My advice, do you know what I say? I mean, that's a very flippant remark, you know. That comes from a friend of mine whose father is a lawyer. He's desperate for his son to be a lawyer, and he's a really decent guitar player. And he hangs out with me, because I'm the big bad guy around the corner. And, he comes around and I say, can you do this? You know? And he goes out and he goes back, and 2 days later he comes back and he plays it better than I do. But it doesn't do much good for his schoolwork. And his father's calling out, say, listen, just leave him alone. Tell him he's no good, will you? So, no, he's great. Can you hear me? My advice would be, if you want to play the guitar for a living, be prepared for some heartbreak, and just be yourself. Just believe in what you do, and if you're good enough, if you have the desire, you'll make a living. You know, it may not be what you, I mean, how I'm still around playing the guitar is just, you know, I find it kind of, I'm busier than ever these days, and yet, if you'd have said to me only 10 years ago, let alone 20 years ago, when I was 14 or 15, sort of you know, what would you be doing in, let's say the turn of the century, you know, people say, oh, are you going to be a manager or something, you know, please, and, but what you don't realise at the time when you're in a, especially when you become in a big band, that most of your audience kind of stays with you, and as you become older, they become older, and they turn on people like this young fella down here, and they say, I'll take you to see a good guy tonight, you might be getting on a bit in this. I say now I'm older and wider, as opposed to wiser. So. But they come along and you can see, you know, these younger guys, but like this friend of mine, people, how old are you?
I'm 14.
14. I've got strings older than you. But they come along and they just, you can see them going like, you know, this old guy can really play, you know. And there's older guys than me who can really play, believe it or not, out there, you know. It's good. And it's, you know, it's been just a roller coaster all the time, really. Things go up and down. I mean, if you're in a big band, you think nothing can get better than this. And then, as a friend over here points out, suddenly, more or less overnight, it was over. I was 30 years old and it was like, now what? And that was a long time ago, you know. To be in a big band and be 30 years old and it finishes was kind of a bit of a blow at the time, you know. I didn't realise it, but so I felt sorry for myself for about 6 months. Oh, I'm going back in playing the guitar, I'm going to be a keyboard player. And everybody will hate me. So that's what it is. So my advice is, if you want to play, you know, practice. Practice? When do I practice? No, I don't. I play every day, there's a difference. But once you know what you want to do, stay true to it. And, yeah, sounds very profound, doesn't it? Yeah. Anybody else, before we do another? No? All right, we'll play with it.
Okay. That's how I learned this list on this. I read the audience, you see, to see what I want to play. we do number four.
This is another homage. This is a really quiet one. Okay, talking then.
Yes, Ben.
We have a problem. Houston, we have a problem. Maybe I've talked that. I've talked too much and the CDs fell over. We could do this.
Is there anything on?
Do you want another one?
It's playing.
It's playing?
Yeah.
No, it's not. That's what you say. All these people will argue with you, I'm sure. The beauty of live work, you see. Yeah. That man there was sitting on it. Just like how we rehearsed it. Yeah, right. Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah, number four, please.
Okay.
Thank you. Any more questions? Yes, sir.
So I used to be you with some connection from the USS Bard, you wrote this poem. I think it was Gary Moore.
There's a picture of me with Gary's.
Yeah.
With mine.
Have you made a YouTube video where you played?
I'm sorry?
Have you made a YouTube video where you played and you borrowed it from the collection of the US?
No, Gary borrowed my guitar.
Oh,
I could never get it back. he was a
but
wonderful.
You don't play the poem anymore?
Yeah. Yeah. I have a couple.
Gibson
made a reissue last year of my 59 Les Paul, and it was a little bit embarrassing because this was kind of in its growing stage. And Paul Reed Smith rang me up and said, "How's the Gibson doing?" I said, "Very well, thank you. It's sold out." But it was a limited edition, so. Young fella downstairs said that they had one in Denmark and it lasted a couple of days. So, there you go. It was nice to have two guitars out with an association at the same time. I mean, that's another thing about, you know, as the years go on, you know, the guitar that I bought 40 years ago suddenly is reissued all over the world and for quite a lot of money. And I was very pleased when they asked me if they would do it. And it sold out before it could leave the factory, so there was obviously a good desire to have it. Is that Jonathan over there?
Yeah.
There's Walter Trout's son over here, ladies and gentlemen. Jonathan Trout. My good friend Walter Trout. How is he?
He's gone embarrassing, why don't you? He's doing all right.
Good.
He got the liver. He's doing better.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. Private conversation with the host. That's nice, isn't it? That's good. Yeah, Walter's he's one of the good guys. Yes, sir.
The Finch Bridge.
Yes, yeah, we tried, we talked about having a, with the prototypes, they did try a couple of, you know, combination. But this one just works really well and it's simple and you can't lose the pieces and it's just everything. I wanted it fairly simple and that's what it is. But they do work well. They work well. Fixed tones. But it's very noisy. Anything else? Anyone want to ask anything?
Which amps do you prefer that's not your own amp?
No, this wouldn't go on the plane.
Okay.
I still use Marshall amps. I use quite a few different amps. I use quite a few different amps in the studio. I've got some old, some very old amps, which just different. When I was doing Shine, which he gave me a great plug for, which I don't have any copies with me. Brilliant. It's online, available at Amazon, anywhere you want to go. It's very, very available. Especially in Denmark at the moment, apparently. Special offer. But I use a lot of old Gibson amps and Fender amps and stuff in the studio. But there's so many modern stuff that you, when you're in the studio now, that you know, I'm not averse to people. Some people, they'd like to think they're very... I mean, I'm fairly traditional. I plug in and out. People say, you know, what effects do you use? I say, I use a guitar, I have the effect. You know, so and but in the studio, it's it'd be kind of crazy not to use some of the facilities that are available now. There's some real good stuff available. So we use some stuff in the studio, but basically there were just a couple of good old Marshall cabinets and stuff, and other bits and pieces. Another one?
Do you still play with Mickey Moody?
Sorry. Go on.
Do you still play with Mickey Moody?
No. Same question. You got the money then? No. He does his own thing, and we haven't worked together in best part of 10 years. I think people tend to think that we lived in a, you know, house here and a house here. It wasn't really like that. But the last, since I had a thing called M3, and since that, I think that finished about 9 years ago, so I've only seen him once in 9 years. So I think your answer is no. Yeah. Same question.
Yeah, I saw on the TV the concert you made in Norway, Live in the Hill.
Live in the
Hill?
Oh, in Lamp, yes, that was 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. You must have been a baby then.
Do you think it's possible that you were spinning on the Blu-ray or DVD or something?
I don't think there was a DVD. There's a bootleg one, I think.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Yeah, bootlegs of everything. Yeah. I did a show in Norway on the radio there with a guitar, a very fine guitar player called Snowy White. And the deal was, they said, can we record it, put it on Norwegian radio? And I said, yeah, the deal is that I get to use the tapes afterwards. But it's been on the radio about 50 times since, and I've never seen the tapes. So. And there you go, that one. Done again, get a good lawyer. All right. Okay, I'm going to do a thing now. I've been lucky enough, or fortunate enough, whatever you look at it, to become pretty good friends with Joe Bonamassa. And, you know, people like Joe and my good friend Walter Trout. Walter's a little bit older than Joe, but without people like Walter, you know, with the torch, with the blues thing over the last 20 years, you know, they've kept it going with, you know, when we lost people like Rory Gallagher and stuff like that. And Joe is one of the younger guys, he's only 37, and has more guitars than me, and he's a lot slimmer than me, so other than that, I really like him. So. We became very good friends about 4 years ago, and maybe a little bit more than that. And a couple of years ago, he sent me an email and just said, we heard a version of this song of yours on the internet. One of these people, probably maybe one of you guys, who take a piece of music and they make their own video. And I'd never seen it. And Joe sent me this, his producer, Kevin Shirley, said, we heard this on... We saw this on YouTube and we thought we would make a really good version of it. So thank you very much. I didn't quite know how to take that. So the next email said, so we did. We'd already recorded it. And this, what I'm going to play now, is the original kind of version of that. It's a song called Place in My Heart, but this is a kind of a guitar version of it. I think this is what they call the blues, I think. I think it's what's called Morris Minor. I think it's the last track. Morris Minor. It's an English joke thing. I think it is. That's not it.
Thank you.
So I have, as I say, a few of these playback, which are ideal for learning to play the guitar. Without these, well, you probably never make it. You're not getting one. I'm already too good. It's been a real pleasure playing for you today, and I'll be around if anybody wants to come and get one of these. They've got plectrums with them and stuff like that. And do you want this one? Yeah. He's younger than you.
There's a young guy here.
Get out of here. Come and see me after you. Don't worry, you're going to pick. Any questions? Any more? Anybody? Yes, sir.
I was wondering about your pickups. Some people prefer microphonic pickups, but how about the noise when you are playing big places? How do you like your...
I usually keep them pretty standard. I mean, whatever comes. I mean, the guys at PRS, they're forever, the tech guys, who I, you know, they may as well speak, you know, Russian or whatever. Because I have no idea really what they're saying to me, you know. dB this and dB that and frequency here, and I'm going, yeah, what color is it? and then they say, well, give me a guitar, and if I go over to Maryland, they'll say, give me the guitar, and they'll take this. They'll say, do you like this guitar? And I say, yeah, I love it. They say, give it to us for an hour. And then I'll rip it apart, and they'll put these new things on. And they'll say, Bernie, it's better. I said, well, I'll tell you that. You know. And then sometimes it is, you know, like one of the ones they did. It wasn't better, it was just different. But on two occasions, I said, yeah, it's really good. And they spent an hour and a half on it, two guys. You know. And I said, really?